فإن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. أما بعد، الحمد لله الذي جمعنا في هذا المكان المبارك. Inshallah, I wanted to talk about two things. This was the week that Abu Bakr As-Siddiq radiAllahu anhu died. And I wanted to talk about the concept of shaja'a or courage in Islam and how that relates to Abu Bakr radiAllahu anhu. When we think of Abu Bakr radiAllahu anhu, we tend to think of an extremely humble person. Sometimes we even imagine almost a weak person in his physical being. We don't imagine the strength of Umar radiAllahu anhu when we think of Abu Bakr. We think of somebody with an incredibly gentle disposition, with a nature that was accepting and forgiving. But Abu Bakr, al-Qadi Abu Bakr ibn al-Arabi, the civilian Qadi from Andalusia, who wrote the book Ahkam al-Qur'an radiAllahu anhu, mentions in the book Qanun al-Ta'wil that no one after the Messenger of Allah had been given the characteristic or the attribute of courage like what was given to Abu Bakr. And then he mentioned a few things, and that made me think, or really rethink, about the nature of Abu Bakr radiAllahu anhu. And reflecting about the concept of courage in Islam. If you look, courage, shaja'a, is one of the four that are called ummahat al-fada'il, the base virtues. These are mentioned by al-Ghazali, they're mentioned by Qadi Abu Bakr and others, and probably before them Aristotle. But these four virtues, from which all the other virtues really stem, according to Qadi Abu Bakr in his book Qanun al-Ta'wil, are al-ilm, wal-adl, wal-shaja'a, wal-irfa. Knowledge, justice, courage, and irfa, which is somebody that restrains himself. It's that characteristic that prevents you from doing those wrong things. Afif is somebody that doesn't ask people, they would never beg, they would never do something against the inherent nature of the being. So shaja'a, if you look at shaja'a, shaja'a is like the characteristic that Allah praises in Quran, a middle characteristic. It's a characteristic between two extremes. The first extreme is called tahawwur. Mutahawwur is a rash person, it's somebody that loses control easily. They charge into things. Sometimes you can see somebody that you think outwardly is a courageous person, when in reality they're a rash person. That is mutahawwur. And the other characteristic or extreme, of which courage is the medium, is cowardliness or timidity. And that is the attribute in the self that creates a fear or generates a fear in the person that petrifies him. Jubna is cheese, and cheese is something that curves. It's not something, the Arabs don't like hard cheese, they like soft cheese. You can ask the Palestinians, because all their cheeses are soft. And the softness is the same thing that jubna, the cowardly characteristic, is that softness, that internal softness. And shaja'a, according to Rab ibn Isbahani, is salamat al-qalb and al-ahwal. It is the firmness of the heart in those awe-inspiring situations. And so the one who has shaja'a or courage is the one that is able to act in the right manner, at the right time, towards the right end. And ends are those things which indicate the character of... The end is the result of which you will know whether that thing is beneficial or not. And because courage is a virtue, then courage will always have a good outcome. Always. And it is the middle way in Islam. Islam is the middle way. And so this shaja'a, according to Raghib Isbahani, there are five types of courage. And I'm going to focus on the last two. The first one is called Suba'iyya, which is like the wild animal current. It's the current that the wild cat or the lion or the tiger has that can rip its opponent apart. And that is, the animals are certainly have a greater portion of that than the human. And the second courage is called Bahimiyya, which is the animal courage that when somebody is hungry or an animal has some sexual desire, then it shows a courage in situations where it need be. If the food is in a place that's difficult to get to, the cat will risk its life to get to the food. And human beings can share that attribute of courage, which is Bahimiyya. And then there's a called Tajribiyya, or experiential courage, which is the courage of a veteran soldier, for instance. If you look at the a new person coming into a battle situation, oftentimes experiences fear because the situation is completely new to him. When he hears bombs going off, or guns going off, or shells, or things being blown up, he has fear. Now the experienced soldier, because he's been in these situations in many different places and in many different times, he will show a courage, a type of courage in that situation, which is from his past experience. So that is experiential courage. And then there is the courage, what Raghib calls al-jihadiyya. And that is the courage that comes from somebody that fights to defend his deen, to defend his country, to defend his honor, to defend his family, to defend his wealth. It's those things that the Sharia has told us, this sacred law has told us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us through the sacred law, that it is a virtue to defend yourself, to defend your country, to defend your deen for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الشَّجَاعَ وَلَوْ فِي قَتْرِ حَيَّةٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves courage even in killing a snake. That it's a characteristic, it is an attribute that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. And like that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates the hawwar, which is a type of ajala, it's a type of hurriedness. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-ajalatu min ash-shaytan wa ta'anni min ar-rahman. That impetuousness, this rashness is from shaitan. That's what shaitan likes to do. Get people to rush into something and then they regret. Once they've rushed in it and they've done it, then they have remorse, they have regret. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates cowardliness. If you look at the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in the end of time, what would afflict us was حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا وَكَرَحِيَةُ الْمَوْتِ. And if you look, حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا is directly connected to lack of courage. Because حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا comes from the fear of provision. And fear of provision is cowardliness. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guaranteed us our provision. وَفِي السَّمَاءِ رِزْقُكُمْ وَمَا تُوَعَدُونَ. In the heaven is your risk, your provision, and what you have been promised. So once you know that, with ilm al-yaqeen, with knowledge of certainty, then you no longer have fear about your provision. So the dunya, hanat alayka, becomes something that is not a big problem. It's not something you get overly worried about. You don't get anxiety attacks. You don't get into this state where you're worried all the time about my provision. My job's on the line, or I just lost my job. What am I going to do? This isn't a state that the mu'min should find himself in. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us through His Prophet that our affair, if you're a mu'min, أمر المؤمن كله خير. That's in Sahih Muslim. Sahih al-Rumi radiallahu anhu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us through His Prophet that our affair, if you're a mu'min, أمر المؤمن كله خير. That's in Sahih Muslim. Sahih al-Rumi radiallahu anhu related that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرَ الْمُؤْمِنِ. How wonderful is the affair of the mu'min. فَأَمْرُهُ كُلُّهُ خَيْرٌ. His affair is all good. إِنْ عَطَاهُ اللَّهُ شَكَرْ وَإِنْ أَصَابَهُ or أَبْتَلَاهُ صَبَرْ وَلَيْسَ ذَلِكَ لِأَحَدٍ سِوَى الْمُؤْمِنِ. If Allah gives him, he's patient. He's thankful. He thanks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if Allah afflicts him, because the mu'min mubtala, the mu'min by nature is in ibtida, dunya is ibtida, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ. To try you, to test you, that's what dunya is about. That's what this world is about. It's about tribulation. It's about trial. It's about suffering. It's about patience. It's about adversity. It's about despair. I mean, look at these people in despair. Look at their life. So the nature of dunya is tribulation. But the mu'min is somebody in abtara'u Allah, sabr. He has patience. That can only come from a courageous man who in the face of tribulation is courageous. You see, he is neither timid nor cowardly, nor is he impetuous or rash. He sees there's a wisdom in this, and I'm going to be patient and ride this out until the wisdom manifests. So this shaja'a al-jihadiyya is where we find Abu Bakr. Now the fifth type of shaja'a is really the crowning type of shaja'a, which is called shaja'a al-hikmiyya, according to Rabi' al-Isbahani, which is the wisdom courage. And he said you will find it in the previous four. These previous four that were mentioned, the wild animal courage, the animal courage, the experiential courage, and the jihad courage, wisdom in all of these. And what wisdom is right action. This is what wisdom is. You see, the Prophet ﷺ was sent لِيُعَلَّمُهُمْ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ to teach them the book and the wisdom. The book is the manual. It tells you how to do it. But the wisdom is the actual example or the embodiment being of the implementation of the manual. And that is wisdom. Right action, right thought, right speech, all of those things. So the shaja'a, or this courageous, this wisdom courage, is the courage that if the man is hungry, he won't steal. Because that's a cowardly act. You see, because how do you steal? Well, none of us steal, but how does a person steal? Not a cowardly act. You see, because how do you steal? Well, none of us steal, but how does a person steal? A person steals by sneaking into something, you see, or he threatens somebody with a gun or a weapon. And that's a coward's way of doing something. So if he's in this bahimiya type of current, it's with wisdom and how he finds his food and how he finds his mate and all these things. And then the tajribiyya is the same thing. Despite the fact that he has a type of courage, he's aware of the other people. He has a wisdom. Now, the wisdom of the jihad is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made from courage shaja'a mahmuda, which is praiseworthy courage. And praiseworthy courage is of two types. And each type has two forms. The first type is mujahadat al-nafs. It's fighting or struggling against the nafs. Because it's only a courageous man that will fight his nafs. The Prophet ﷺ said, لَيْسَ الشَّدِيدُ شَدِيدُ الصَّرَعَةِ. The strong one amongst you, which is a courageous one, is not the one who wrestles and can throw people over. وَلَكِنْ الشَّدِيدُ مَنْ مَلَكَ نَفْسَهُ عَنْدَ الْغَضَبِ. But the strong one is the one that controls himself when he becomes angry. So this type of courage, Mujahadatun Nafs, is from Shaja'a Mahmuda. It's a praiseworthy courage. And the Mujahada of the Nafs is of two types, Al-Qawli wal-Fi'li. Mujahadatul Qawl is learning, Ta'allum, is forcing your Nafs to learn, to acquire knowledge. Acquiring knowledge is not easy. It means Sahar al-Layali. It's staying up in the night. It's finding time. It's forcing yourself to come to the masjid when you don't want to come to the masjid. That's mujahada. If it was always easy, then where's the tribulation? Where's the mujahada? Where's the test? وَمَنْ يُجَاهِدُ فِينا لَنَهْدِيَنُهُمْ سُبَلَنَا. The ones who struggle in us, they struggle in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in His way, then Allah guides them. So where's the struggle? If everything comes easy, where is the struggle? There's no struggle. So there has to be mujahada in ta'allum. If you want to learn, you have to struggle. If you want to acquire Arabic, you don't put on tapes and go to sleep after paying $900 for the course. And wake up in the morning and you speak fluent Arabic. It doesn't work like that. That's just somebody fooling a lot of people, making a lot of money. Learn in your sleep. You can't learn in your sleep. In fact, learning is the process of waking up. That's what it is. It's waking up. The Prophet ﷺ said, "An-nasu niyyat." Humanity is asleep. وَإِذَا مَاتُوا انْتَبَهُوا. But when they die, they wake up. And then in Sahih Muslim, he said, "عُدُّوا أَنفُسُكُمْ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ الْقُبُورِ." Consider yourselves dead. In other words, wake up now. Be awake now. Don't wait.
wait until you die to find out what's going to happen. Find out now, because the news is here. The news is in the book. The Quran will tell you what's going to happen. Don't wait until the alarm goes off, which is when your ruh is literally ripped out of your body, in spite of itself. إِذَا بَلَغَتَ الْحُلْقُونَ. When it reaches the hulqum. So this shaja'a of the mahmuda is qawl, which is learning. And the second is fi'l, which is mujahada of qam' al-shahawat with tahdhib al-himya. It is subduing the passion, those lower nafs. And tahdhib al-himya is refining one's regime. What does that mean? The first one means that if you eat too much, you have to lessen your food. If you have a stomach, get rid of it. Because the Prophet ﷺ did not like big stomach. And he used to, if he saw somebody with a big stomach, he would point it out. And he would say to them, كَانَ خَيْرًا لَوْ كَانَ فِي غَيْرِكَ. It would have been a good thing if it was on somebody else. In other words, if that extra fat you have was on a thin person, then it would be a good thing. But all that food that you're eating, you don't need. And where's the proof? The proof is there. The proof is in the pudding. You know what pudding is? That's dessert. That's an English saying, pudding. Proof is in the pudding. So that's where the proof is. It's in the barfi. So that's mujahada. Getting, subduing that nafs. If you sleep too much, you have to cut it out. Because the nature of the nafs is that it's lazy. That is the nature of the nafs. It is lazy. And unless you have a motivational factor in your life, nothing's going to happen. And the two most profound motivational factors in the human being are tarhib and tarhib. And all you have to do is read the Quran, and you'll very quickly find out that it is a book that is about tarhib and tarhib. It's about telling us about Jannah and reminding us about the fire. And if those aren't the most, the two of the most outstanding and powerful motivators, Jannah and Naar, pain and pleasure, the ultimate pain and the ultimate pleasure. If those don't motivate you, then there's no Iman. That is what the indication is. Ahmed Zarruq said, مَنْ أَدْرَكَ مَقَامَ الْإِسْلَامِ مَا فَتَرَ عَنِ الْعَمَلِ. The one that realizes the maqam of Islam, he'll never be tired of action. He won't be tired of action because he knows about tarhib and tarhib, and that's going to keep him motivated and keep him moving. But there has to be that courage to rise up and oppose the self. If the courage isn't there, then the person is idle, he's weak, he's timid, he's cowardly. And if he's rash, you see what the rash person will do is he'll say, that's it, I'm going to fight my nafs. And he'll go home and he'll stay the whole night. Read the Quran, tahajjud, and then right before Fajr, he falls asleep. And then he sleeps half the day because he's so tired. That is impetuous. That is impetuousness. That is rashness. The intelligent one says, that's true, I have to change my life. What I'm going to start doing, I'm not going to start doing 11 rak'ahs every night. I'm going to do, if I'm only doing shafa and witr, which everybody should be doing, because I saw in a book once, the times that I missed it, I regretted deeply. After I saw in a book once that said, and it was in Ibn al-Hajj, on the Murshid al-Mu'in, he said, مَا تَرَكَ الْوِتْر إِلَّا أَفْسَقَ النَّاسِ. Only the worst people leave witr. That's a terrible category to be. So if one's only doing with shafa and witr, then do two rak'ahs. Commit yourself to doing two rak'ahs every night. Make that commitment. From now on, until I die, I am going to do at least two rak'ahs before I do shafa and witr. And start that. If you've been doing it, they say, in order to create a habit, you need 21 days. And there's a proverb that says, كُلُّ شَيْءٍ بِالْعَادَ وَلَوَ الْعِبَادَ. Everything is habitual, even worship. You have to habituate yourself to doing that, you see. So do that for a certain amount of time, a month, 2 months. Once you feel, now I'm established, make it 4 rak'ahs. And then make it 6. And then make it 8. And then make it 11. And then you're at where the Prophet ﷺ stopped, and that's the best place to be. But do that little change, just that little change, and Allah will make big opening. Great things come from small changes. That is a truth. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, خَيْرُ الْعَمَالِ أَدْوَمُهَا وَإِنْ خَلَّتْ. The best of actions are those that continue, even if they're little ones. Because that continuity of action is what necessitates hidayah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When He sees that you are serious, then He gives you strength. That is what necessitates hidayah. Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah radiallahu anhu said that there's a myth, some attributed to the Prophet, مَنْ تَرَكَ شَيْئًا لِلَّهِ عَوَّضَهُ اللَّهُ بِشَيْءٍ خَيْرٍ. Whoever leaves a thing for Allah, Allah will replace it with a thing that's better than that. What Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah said, that the fool thinks, if he leaves it for one day, he's going to get that replacement that's better. So people say, I'm giving up television. They turn off the television, 2 days, 3 days, they start getting sweaty palms, they start getting into withdrawal symptoms. I'll just watch CNN, just once, switch it on, and then after CNN, I don't know what comes on after that, but something, or it just keeps going, which is even worse. So there you are, you're watching it, nothing happened. Now, what Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah said, Allah doesn't care if you leave something for a few days. He wants to see the continuity to test you. Is this person sincere? And once he sees the sincerity, then he gives the awad. He gives you that replacement of a thing that's better than it. You see, that's something like free time. If you leave television, you're going to get free time. And that is one of the biggest blessings, because the Prophet ﷺ said, نِعْمَتَانِ مَغْضُونٌ فِيهِمَا كَثِيرٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ. Two great blessings, ni'mah, that most people are cheated out of. As-sihha wa al-faraq, their health and their free time. And shaitan, he's the one cheating you out of it, because that's his job. So, that is the mujahada of nafs. Al-qawl and fi'l. Qawl is learning and fi'l is suppressing itself. And then tahdib al-himya is changing your regime, which has to do with coming to the masjid. Deciding, I'm going to pray as many prayers as I can in the masjid. That is a tahdib al-himya of changing your food pattern. If you're overeating, then you start, just be satiated. Don't eat. One man burped in front of the Prophet ﷺ and he said, أَكْفِفْ عَنَّا جَشَأَكَ. Don't burp in front of us. He said, وَاللَّهِ أَكْثَرُ نَا شَبْعًا فِي الدُّنْيَا أَطْوَلَهُمْ جُوعًا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامِ. Those people that are the most satiated in this world are the ones that have the longest hunger on Yawm al-Qiyamah. The Prophet ﷺ, he didn't do those things. Some people, they come to the masjid after eating a big meal and you're praying, and then you get this foul smell that diffuses from people eating garlic and things. It's unbelievable. I mean, if you think about it, it's happened to me in Salah, in Jannah. When you enter into Salah, you're entering into, that's why people, they wore perfume and things like that. So the Sahaba, they love fine smell. The Prophet said, بَخِّرُوا مَسَاجِدَكُمْ. Put incense in your masajid. Because Allah loves beautiful smells. So, that is the mujahadah. And then there's mujahadah al-ayn, which is jihad. Right? Jihad. Struggle. That's what it means. Struggle. They like that. And jihad has two types. Al-qawl wa al-fi'l. The qawl is speaking the truth to the munafiqeen, to the kuffar, telling them what the truth is. Your deen is batil. The Prophet ﷺ, he didn't, if you look at his usloob of da'wah, his method of calling to people, he didn't engage in long conversations. He didn't spend all this time and then maybe after 5 years mention, you know, I'm a Muslim, I pray 5 times. You know anything about Islam? Right? He asked people straight out, what are you worshipping? فَأَيْنَ تَذْهَبُونَ. I was commanded to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people came to him, that the Persian, and they had shaved beard, and they had mustache growing over. And they still do that, a lot of Persians, to this day. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, what is that? مَنْ أَمَرْكُمْ بِهَذَا. They said, Kisra, the Kisra. He said, بِئْسَ مَا أَمَرْكُمْ بِهِ. What a terrible thing he's told you to do. He said, أَمَرَنِي رَبِّي أَنْ أَعْفُ الْبَحْيَا وَأَحُبُّ الشَّارِ. My Lord commanded me to grow my beard and trim my mustache. That's what he told them. He asked you. So that is action. Oh, and then you have action, which is fighting. Fisabilillah. Struggling fisabilillah. When haq is there, when boom is there, you have to oppose oppression. That's what it is. Not terrorist bombing and things. This is a disclaimer, right? Not terrorist bombing. We're not terrorists. We have to tell them because they don't believe us. But we're not, right? We don't blow up buildings. Nobody here inshallah blows up any buildings. We don't do that. But we're supposed to fight. If we're oppressed, we're supposed to fight. If we see people oppressed, we're supposed to fight. And that takes courage. And now we get back to courage. So I just want to look at Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. This man is so awesome. He is the proof of the Prophet ﷺ. Even if the Prophet ﷺ, and we can say things like, some people say, لَوْ يَفْتَحْ بَابِ الشَّيْطَانِ is a hadith, that if opens up the door of shaitan. But if of khair is alright, like Ahmed ibn Hanbal said, لَوْ لَمْ يَنْزِلْ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى فِي كِتَابِهِ إِلَّا سُورَةَ الْعَصَرِ لَا كَفَتْنَا. If Allah had only revealed Surah Al-Asr in the Quran, it would have been enough for us. Because everything there, وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ إِذَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا صَالِحًا وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. That's the whole deen right there. So, even had the Prophet ﷺ not given us anything other than Abu Bakr, that would have been a proof of who he was. Because Abu Bakr is awesome. He is an incredible human being. The Prophet ﷺ said, لَوْ كَانَ إِمَانُ أُمَّتِي فِي كُفَّةٍ وَإِمَانُ أَبِي بَكْرٍ فِي كُفَّةٍ لَرَجَحَ. إِمَانُ أَبِي بَكْرٍ. If all of the iman of my ummah was in one scale, and Abu Bakr's iman in the other scale, Abu Bakr's would have outweighed us. It's unbelievable. Now look at who this man is. This man was born about 2 years after the Prophet. The Arabs used to date their time from Al Fil, which is the year of the elephant. Everybody knows Abraha, this foolish Ethiopian man who was in Yemen, decided he's going to build something like the Kaaba to get the tijara, the merchants, to start people making pilgrimage so he could make more money, right? Take away business from Quraysh. So he decided, well, I have to destroy Kaaba. So he goes to destroy Kaaba. And we know what happened. And so from that day then, the Arabs dated the calendar. And to this day, if you go, I live with the Bedouin, you say, when were you born? They say, oh, the year, the Gleeg al-Fajr, like the year the dam broke. That they still do that, because they're not people that follow time like we do. They just have events. And so Amr al-Fil was a big event. Abu Bakr was born 2, maybe 3 years after. He was born into a noble, many times he was born into a noble Qurayshi family. He was a merchant. He by his own words, and he's the most truthful of men after the Prophet ﷺ, was one of the wealthiest men in Mecca. Now, if you look, there is one phrase that is his shi'ar. It is is that thing that identifies Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And that is, إِنْ قَالَهُ فَقَدْ سَبَقَ. If he said it, then it's true. He didn't need to know anything other than if it came out of the Prophet ﷺ's mouth, it was true. Now, when at the time that the Prophet ﷺ, right before the Ba'tha, there was a lot going on in Mecca. There were hulafa that knew that this thing wasn't true. Qis ibn Sa'idah, there was Nawfal, Waraqa ibn Nawfal. There were people that knew that the Hanif way was not what the Quraysh were practicing. And what they were doing, they were idolaters, worshipping Baal. They knew that. Now Abu Bakr was a deeply, he would be what we would categorize in modern terminology, he was an intellectual. He was somebody that knew all of the nasab of the Arabs before Islam. He knew all the nasab, which indicates the type of intellect. He had a deeply analytical and a very powerful intellect. He also knew all the poetry of the Arabs. He knew their poetry. He was a deep thinker. He was also the best friend of the Prophet ﷺ before Islam. So if that's his choice of companion, that is an indication again of who he is. Now, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he used to go to Syria a lot, Sham, and he was in Sham right before the Ba'tha, and he saw a dream. And the dream was that a moon
came down from the sky over Mecca and burst into several different pieces, this light. And then each one of the pieces went into every house in Mecca. And then the pieces came back, reformed the moon, and then came onto his lap. The moon is the Prophet ﷺ, because the moon is light in the darkness. When everything's dark, it is the moon that gives light. In the daytime, the sun's there. You don't need, the light is there. People can see clearly when day is there, and day is hot. But nighttime is dhulma, is oppression, is tyranny, is all these things. And this is what they were doing. So the Prophet ﷺ, he had his dream. He went to one of the Christians, because he knew he used to talk to them in Syria. There were so many religions there. And he used to talk and engage in them. And he told one of them what was happening, this dream. And this priest told him, the time is coming when the last prophet will come. Now these people knew there was a prophet coming. They were aware of that fact. This is a historical fact. There were Jews in Yathrib. Now, we know that our cousins like to go where you make a lot of money, right? Generally. And certainly the best place to go in the Arabian Peninsula was Mecca, because that's where all the pilgrims were. But that wasn't where they were. They were in Medina, because their books did not describe Mecca. It described Medina as the place where that messenger would manifest. And that's where they were. They were in Yathrib waiting. They knew he was coming. There was no other reason for them to be there. The same is true of the Christians. Buhayra, we know about Buhayra. This man knew that a messenger was coming, and he knew he was coming from Arabia. And when he saw the Prophet ﷺ being covered with the shade, he knew he was in there, and he called them. So they had knowledge, their book. Now, recently, you know, the Dead Sea Scrolls, they founded these Dead Sea Scrolls. For 40 years, they have kept those books completely locked up. The only people who are allowed to look at them have been Catholic priests and Jewish rabbis. No other researchers or scholars. There was a big battle in the scholarly community that they did not let lay people get in there to look at these. They only allowed the Catholic Church and the Jewish government, Israeli government. So the Nag Hammadi library that was discovered in Egypt in 1948, within 4 years, and it was actually a larger group of books in the same language around the same era, within 4 years was completely published. These books that they found describe a sect that was living in the area of Qumran at the time of Isa alayhi salam, and they were waiting for a prophet, the last prophet. Now, we know that his name, sallallahu alayhi salam, is mentioned by name in those books. We know that because Isa gave tabshir of Ahmad, and we know that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ. They know him like they know their own children. So this information is kept from people. Now, when Abu Bakr went back, he goes back in the on his way back, the Prophet had his, this was a 30-day journey. He had his first revelation. اَقْرَأْ بِسْمِ رَبِّكَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ. And then he begins, first he tells his wife Khadija, then he tells Barakat and Nofat, and then he begins to tell people. When the Qafida gets back, they come out, as was their tradition, to meet the Qafida. When they got there, Abu Jahl was out there, his name was Abu al-Hakam, and he said to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, do you know what happened? This big event has happened. Your companion is claiming he's getting revelation from God, and he's claiming that he's a final prophet. When Abu Bakr heard this, this is the first time that he said, in qalahu faqad sadaq. Now this is a man who knew the Prophet ﷺ all of his life. He knew him since the time they were children. He knew who he was, he knew his characteristics, and he knew he was al-Amin. He goes home, he greets his family, he goes to the Prophet's house. Khadija lets him in. He says to the Prophet, أَصَحِيمَ مَا قَالِ لِأَخْرَعَهُ. Is it true what they said? And he said, مَاذَ أَنْبَأَكَ يَا عَتِيق. His name was Atiq before Islam. And the Prophet ﷺ, Abu Bakr tells him, they say you're saying, and he said, it's true. And he said, أَشْهَدُ إِنَّكَ أَصَادِقَ لَمْ.
Everybody, the Prophet Sallallahu said, had a qadwa before they became Muslim, except Abu Bakr. He, radiallahu anhu, didn't hesitate. The Prophet said, kullu ummati kanat lahum qadwa haynama aradtuhum illa Abu Bakr. He didn't even hesitate. He said, "Ana ashhadu annaka anta sadiq al-amin." That's who you are. If this is what you're telling me, I know it's true. That's all he needed to know. That's his first mawqif. You have to look at that in relation to the bi'ah. The Prophet ﷺ, Abu Bakr saw the humiliation that these other people, Qais ibn Sa'idah and these other people, had from their own people by just rejecting their God. When he said that, he was making an act, a courageous act. I am standing by it. The first thing he does is he takes some of the best, finest of Quraysh and he convinces them. Abu Bakr, he goes out, he got Uthman ibn Affan, and he said, you know who this man is. You know who he is. Uthman said, you're right. Uthman becomes Muslim. He got Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas. I mean, great men. Zubair ibn Awwan, Abdurrahman ibn Awf, Abu Ubaidah. These are the people who he went out and got. He got them immediately, Abu Talha. And they became Muslim, and then the Islam begins to spread. And it spreads amongst the poor, right? This is where it spreads. Then the Quraysh are starting to constrict the Muslims. Some of them they were torturing, some of them they were making economic boycotts on. They boycotted Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. His money, he started losing his wealth. He was also spending money. He was freeing slaves. He freed Bilal. When Bilal said, "Aina anta wa Abu Bakr? Where are you in relation to Abu Bakr?" Bilal said, "Ma ana illa hasana min hasanatihi. I'm just a good deed from his good deeds. That is my relation to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq." And so Abu Bakr, during this time, he's always by the Prophet. Anything he hears, he rushes out to defend the Prophet ﷺ. And he warns them. He's constantly warning them, don't touch this man. And he's always by his side. And this is his maqam. This is who Abu Bakr is. And then when the time for the hijrah comes to Al-Habasha, Abu Bakr is in the front line. He wants to make hijrah fi sabilillah, because they were becoming so harsh on himself, and he didn't have anybody to back him. One of the wealthy of the Quraysh and one of the strong people of Quraysh said, no, you shouldn't leave. You're one of the best people in this city and I'll defend you. And so he stayed and he was given a respite for some time. And then they begin again to put pressure on him. And then finally, if you look, the Muslims then get the idhn to make hijrah to Medina. And they begin to make hijrah and they're going. Umar radiallahu anhu goes, Hamza radiallahu anhu goes. All of these big Sahaba are going. Only a handful are left, Suhaib al-Rumi. Now Suhaib al-Rumi, Abu Bakr promised him that he would make hijrah with him. Sayyidina Ali is with the Prophet ﷺ. The night that the Prophet ﷺ is given idhn, he goes to Abu Bakr and he says, As-Sahba ya Abu Bakr. And he said, "A'adhinti ya Rasulullah, you were given permission?" And he said, "Na'am." He said, "Wa ana," and he said, "As-sahba, you are my companion." And so, Asma, the daughter of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, that nitaqin, who also, what courage she showed, she's the one that took food to them. She's the one that provided the camels. She's the one that helped them to make this flight. And so they go, they make this flight, and they... Now you have to, it's important for us to be aware of a few things here. The first thing is, the Quraysh were letting the other Muslims make hijrah. Why? Because they were actually now plotting to kill the Prophet. But they wanted his followers to convince him. The first thing is, the Quraysh were letting the other Muslims make hijrah. Why? Because they were actually now plotting to kill the Prophet. But they wanted his followers to be out of the city. Because we know they had Ta'af system, they were worried that it's going to be a problem amongst the tribes. And so Abu Bakr knew this. They wanted to kill the Prophet ﷺ. And Abu Bakr knew that going with the Prophet ﷺ on this hijrah was basically the most dangerous thing that he's ever going to do. And he didn't care because he's going to be with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And so they go to the Jabal al-Thawb. Now another thing to remember is you cannot, the Sahara is this huge place, right? But the Arabs were master trackers. This is what they were masters of. They could find anything by tracing their track. When I was in Mauritania, we came over a kidya, a high mountain peak. And right as we came over, this Bedouin boy that I was with said, "Oh, look at that man over there. He lost his camels." And I looked, and I'm saying, "Where?" He said, "Over there." And I'm looking, I couldn't see anything. It took me maybe 5 minutes. And then I saw this little ant-like figure out in the middle of nowhere, and there was camels that were also looked like ants over to the other side. And he said he's trying to find his camel. He saw that just coming over the horizon. They knew all the tracks. They knew animals. They were masters of this. So don't think that they were fleeing, you know, into safety. They would probably have been safer to stay and hide in Mecca than to go out into the desert. And so what did they get? Suraqa ibn Malik, who's one of the best trackers of the Arabs, when they hear they're offering 100 camels for the best of creation. This is the element of idiocy that had afflicted these people. When Umar radiallahu anhu said that the Arabs, they used to make idols out of dates, and then when they got hungry, they ate them. He said, "Ya Rasulullah, where were our brains yawma'idin? Ayna kanat 'uquluna?" When he reflected, but that is what ghafla is. You see, that is what, if you're a ghafil, you're mughaffa. Mughaffa is a simpleton in the Arabic language. Mughaffa means like a simpleton, a stupid person. They say, "Mughaffa, ya'ani khalli ma'ani." He's simple. Just leave him alone. And that's what ghafla is. When you're in ghafla, you can't use your intellect. Because intellect is light. It's nur. That's what it is. It is the light that Allah has given you to guide yourself in this world through following Allah's messengers. You have to follow with your intellect. أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ? That's what Allah said. أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ? Don't you use your intellect? So they have lost their intellect. Offering 100 camels. So they go to Jabal al-Thawb, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They go in, and I went there. It's a very small cave there. They went inside the cave, and 3 nights they stayed there. 3 days and 3 nights. The Arabs found them quickly. That it wasn't difficult for them. They walked all around Jabal al-Thawb. They got there. The tracker goes up, and they find the tracks end at the cave. But there's a spider's web, and there's a dove's nest with the eggs still in it. And this tracker says, "They couldn't have gone in here." And they said, "Why not?" He said, "No, it's impossible for these two things to be here." That's a materialist. That's the materialistic mind functioning at its best. You see, that man could not conceive of anything out of what they call khariq al-ada or mu'jiza, anything out of the normal, anything out. His tracking skills, of which he was the finest, told him it is impossible for a man to be in this cave with this spider web untouched, because a spider could not have built that web in the time it took them to get to this place. That's what his materialistic understanding told him. And there the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is, in there. And Abu Bakr said, "Wallahi, if he would have just looked down at his feet, he would have seen them." Imagine this man, the most courageous of men, he's not worried about himself. He's worried about the man he's with. That's who he was worried about. He went in to clean out the cave. They had snakes in there. He went in to clean out the cave. The two of them. Inna Allaha ma'ana. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Ya Abu Bakr, la takhaf. Ma wannuka bi ithnayn thalithuhum Allah." What do you think of two? The third is Allah. In one tradition that I heard from Shaykh Atiyah in Medina, and he mentioned that there was weakness. Some of the seerah mentioned these things, but
Because it said that Allah anzala alayhi sakina, that He made this sakina come down. And one of the traditions was that Abu Bakr looked at the back of the cave and there was an opening and he saw the Red Sea with a boat there. Allah Akbar. So these men leave because there's nobody there in their reckoning. And then the camels are brought and they set out on the journey. Suraqa, he wants this 100 camels. He's convinced that this is a big reward. So he sets out with his best jawad, his steed, and he goes out and he tracks them down because he was a great tracker. So he gets there and Suraqa said, I could see the two of them. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was reciting something. And Abu Bakr kept looking back. It's so beautiful because it's an act of love. That's what it was. His fear is the fear of the most courageous of men. Because he's not fearing himself, he's fearing his beloved, his Habib, the Habib of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he's looking back worried about this situation. Every time Suraqa gets close, his horse starts sinking in the sand. Now Suraqa was very intelligent and he knew that this was not normal because he was a master of the desert. And after this happened 3 times, he said, I give up. And he told them, I'm not going to go any further. And then the transaction happens and the Prophet ﷺ told them, how much did they offer you? And he said, 100 camels. He said, Ya Suraqa, Aina anta wa atawar of Kisra? Where are you and the bracelets of Kisra? And alhamdulillah, he wore them when they got to Medina and he became Muslim later. And then Omar, when the gold of Kisra came, Omar held up the asawir. And Suraqa told, he said, the Prophet said that I would wear those. And so Omar gave them to Suraqa and he put them on. And then Suraqa, he was going to take them. Omar said, where are you going? Well, the Prophet said, I was going to wear them. He said, you wore them, now put them back. So then he goes to Medina, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and they arrive there. And the Prophet goes into the house of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, and then things start to happen in Medina. People have all become Muslim, there's munafiqeen, the Jews are problematic, these things are happening in Medina, Abu Bakr is there with the Prophet. When Ghazwat Badr comes, where is Abu Bakr? In the tent with the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet imploring in his dua, Ya Allah, in ahlakta hadhihi ta'ifa, falan yabqa ala al-ard man ya'buduka. If you destroy this small group here, nobody will remain on the earth to worship you. And he's doing it so much. Now the Prophet ﷺ, this is his ilhar al-ubudiyya. We have to understand that. The Prophet is manifesting his slavehood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Abu Bakr says, Ya Rasulullah, it's enough. He promised you the nasr. He's telling him, because he's looking at him and seeing him in this agitated state, which is, the Prophet, his heart's not agitated. He knows, because he has yaqeen. But this is his manifesting ubudiyya to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so, then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu in Uhud, when they were, the Muslims all begin to fall apart after the people are disobedient and the kuffar are yumatinun, they were making, mutilating the body. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was there and he said he looked and he saw Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu running alone with his sword out towards the ranks of the mushrikeen, alone to stop them from mutilating the bodies of the Muslims. And Abu Bakr and the Prophet ﷺ said, "Ahmid sayfik, ya Abu Bakr, put your sword away. La tafda'ni bi nafsika. Don't overwhelm me by losing yourself." And Abu Bakr came back. He always obeyed everything the Prophet ﷺ said. Now, the one thing I didn't mention, when the Isra happened in the 10th year of Hijrah, again Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was out. The Prophet Abu Jahl came, asked the Prophet, what did you do? What's the news? مَا أَحْدَثَ رَبُكَ بِكَ. And he said that he went to Bayt al-Maqdis. And he said, are you going to tell your companions this? And then he called the Quraysh, Abu Jahl. He's Fir'aun of this Ummah, he calls Quraysh, and they come.
And he said, listen to what he has to say now. Now some of the Muslims had doubt. And some of them actually left Islam at this point. Because it took them a month to go to Bayt al-Maqdis. And the Prophet ﷺ said it happened in one night. Now, what did Abu Hakam think immediately? Atiq. If he will make Ridda, if he'll turn away, everybody's going to meet the Prophet ﷺ. So they rush to Abu Bakr and they tell him what he said. And then he said, what do you say? And Abu Bakr said, in qalbu faqad saq. If he said it, it's true. And they're amazed, and he said, وَلَا إِنَّنِي لَأُصَدِّقُهُ فِي مَا هُوَ أَبْعَدُ مِنْ ذَلِكَ أُصَدِّقُهُ بِأَنَّ الْوَحِيِّ يَنْزِلُ مِنْ فَوْقَ سَبْعَ سَمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ غُدْوَةً وَرَوْحًا. I believe in something even more difficult to believe. If you're going to measure things in these materialistic terms, then let's look at something serious. Not taking one, going to Bayt al-Maqdis in one night. What about heavenly news in one instant coming down to the Prophet ﷺ? Isn't that more amazing? And I believe him in that. That this is iman of somebody who's, he's thinking. It's somebody who's using his intellect. It's not a blind faith. It's somebody who's reflecting on the reality of the situation. And he believed him. That was Muqad Shaja'ah. And then when they go to Medina and these things happen, Uhud happens, and then it goes on, alhamdulillah, they go to make the Hajj in the fifth year of the Hijrah. They're going to make the Umrah, and they're going to make the Tawaf of the Bayt. When they get there, just outside, they send Uthman ibn Affan in, Suhayl ibn Amr, and other Quraysh come out, and they say they're not going to let them come in. And not many of the Muslims were armed at that point. They said they can't come in. They decide to arbitrate. What they decide on, the Prophet ﷺ decides that they will not make the pilgrimage that year. They'll go back to Medina, that anybody that flees to them from Mecca, they will send them back. And yet anybody that wants to go back from Medina, the Quraysh don't have to send them back. This is the treaty that they make. The Prophet ﷺ says that he'll sign with his khatam. And all of the Sahaba, they can't believe this. Now this is Shaja'a, courage, is that thing that manifests when people lose control. It's the one that's steadfast in the midst of something that's awesome, that's overwhelming. And this is too much for these men. Umar, who is the second after Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, says to the Prophet, أَلَسْتَ نَبِيٍّ حَقًّا? Aren't you really a prophet? Umar, with all the respect, this is what a great man. Inshallah, I want, after we talk about Abu Bakr, inshallah, in a few weeks, talk about Umar, inshallah. He's so great. But Umar, has tremendous courage, but he has rashness in his courage. If you watch his progression, by the time he becomes Khalifa, he's got that balance, that complete balance. But during that period, the Prophet is constantly having to hold him back because he was impetuous. He wanted the truth to come out now. He wasn't willing to realize that at times you have to compromise. This was his nature, and it's a great attribute that he had, but the Prophet honed it. So he says, أَلَسْتَ نَبِيًّا حَقًّا? Aren't you really the man? And he said, بَلَى. The Prophet said, بَلَى. And then he said, إِذَنْ لِمَالَ فَرْطَ بِالدَّنِيَّةِ فِي الدِّينِ? Why are you being content with this low thing about deen? And the Prophet said, Ya Umar, إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ لَا عَصِيهِ وَإِنَّهُ نَاصِرُ. Umar, he reminds him, who do you think I am? I am the messenger of Allah. I don't disobey my Lord. In other words, what I am doing now is not disobeying my Lord. I'm in the obedience of my Lord. Don't think I'm disobeying my Lord. And Umar radiallahu anhu said, أَلَمْ تَقُولَ النَّاسَ نَقُولَ الْبَيْتِ? See, he's still not convinced, even after the Prophet ﷺ said that. So if this is Umar, think of the other Muslims. Think of the other Muslims. He said, didn't you say we'll make tawaf of the house? أَوَقُدْتُ هَذَا الْعَمْ يَا عُمَرْ? I mean, the Prophet, he's having to defend himself before Umar. And Umar, at this point, his adab made him stop. He goes, he's still not, he's still boiling inside. And the only person he can think to go to, Abu Bakr. There's no, who else are you going to talk to after the Prophet? He goes to Abu Bakr, and Abu Bakr grabs his hand. He said, جَذَبَنِي بِيَدِّهِ بِقُوَّةٍ. He grabbed my hand with force and squeezed it, and said, وَيْحَكَ يَا بِنَ الْخَطَّابِ. Beware, Ibn al-Khattab. هَذَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. Who do you think that is? وَاللَّهِ لَا يَعْصِي رَبَّهُ وَإِنَّهُمْ نَاصِرُهُ وَاتَّقِ اللَّهِ Fear Allah. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, والله ما من لحظة إلا شرح الله صدري ونزل على قلبي سكينة. From that, it didn't happen. When the Prophet telling him this thing, he's still falling over. When he goes to Abu Bakr, a Siddiq grabs him, no doubt in his heart. Who do you think he is? And Abu Bakr said, the Sakina comes down into the heart and he becomes tranquil. And then that Sakina spread. I mean, this, look at these fitan that the Abu Bakr is the key element. This amazing man. And then when they, we move on, when Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, during the time the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam becomes sick, who does he appoint to lead the prayer? Abu Bakr. Now the imam in Islam is the leader. The imam is the leader. He's the one that goes in front. And so he appoints Abu Bakr. Aisha, the daughter of Abu Bakr, radiallahu anhu. Aisha, radiallahu anhu, has said, Ya Rasulullah, أمر عمر يا أم الناس. فوالله إن أبا بكر رقيق ضعيف إذا قرأ القرآن بكى ولا يسمع. Let Omar lead the prayer, because Abu Bakr, he's weak and he has such a riqqa, you know, raqa'iq of the those things that break the heart. And he had this riqqa in his heart. And so the Prophet ﷺ said, tell Aisha that Abu Bakr should lead the prayer. So Aisha goes out and tells Hafsa. Go in and tell him. See, this is radiallahu anha. Goes and tells. Then Hafsa comes in and says, Ya Rasulullah, Abu Bakr, and she tries to do the same thing. And he said, Ya Salah ibn Yusuf. See, the women of Yusuf. Inna kayda kunna azim. Your plot is bad. So he, and then Hafsa said, she was so mad. Because Aisha tricked her a few times. The one about the honey, she Aisha got Hafsa into trouble more than once. So Hafsa regrets at this point, she regrets doing this thing. She goes out, now Aisha. So Abu Bakr leads the prayer. For 10 days the Prophet is sick. A few times he comes out being carried by the Sahaba. One point he even came out by himself. Abu Bakr was going to allow him to lead the prayer. Abu Bakr finishes the prayer. So this is a big tribulation at this point. The Prophet ﷺ, finally, the 10th day, he comes out. He looks so well. They thought he's out of his sickness. Abu Bakr has been at his side all this time. He thinks that he's gotten well. He said, Ya Rasulullah, adinni, let me go, because Abu Bakr had a house. He had a house next to the masjid, and he also had a house just outside of Medina. And he said, I need to go to my family. Will you give me permission? And he said, go. So he goes to his family. And the Prophet ﷺ, then he ordered all of the doors into the masjid to be closed up, except Quwwat Abi Bakr, the window of Abu Bakr. That's the only door he left open. He's given ishara. These are all ishara of who. There's powerful ishara that Ali was the one that the Prophet ﷺ was going to leave as Khalifa. Abbas at this point comes to Ali and says, according to Ibn Hisham, comes to Ali and says, let's go ask the Prophet ﷺ, because wallahi, ash-sha'nu sha'nuka, this thing is going to go to you if he dies. And Ali says, la wallahi, I don't want to go and ask him. He said, if he doesn't allow us to take it, then it will never come, no one would ever allow it to come to us. Not meaning him, but the family of the Prophet ﷺ. So it's important to remember that Ali knows the Prophet ﷺ's deen. He's the most learned of the Sahaba, and the Prophet ﷺ said that he never gives the wilayah to the one who seeks it. And so The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The news comes to Abu Bakr, he immediately rushes to the masjid. Imagine this scene. The Muslims are in a complete turmoil. The munafiqun are saying things, because now they've got their opportunity to come up. Omar swinging his sword back and forth, saying, Wallahi, those who say that the Prophet ﷺ died are the munafiqun. The Prophet ﷺ didn't die, he's gone like Musa ibn Imran to his Lord and he's coming back. Wallahi, anyone that says that he's dead, I'll chop his head off. Again, that rashness coming out. It's too much for Omar. He can't bear. Uthman, completely silent. Ali goes into his home. He goes and goes into the house of Fatima. The big Sahaba are in a state of complete agitation. Abu Bakr comes, he sees the situation. I mean, this is a man, he's assessing the situation. What's going on here? He heard the na'i, the man telling the death of the Prophet. He goes into the house of the Prophet ﷺ, the bayt of Aisha radiallahu anha. He pulls the cover, he sees the Prophet ﷺ, ascertains that he is dead, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, Ya Rasulullah, قَدْ تُبْتَ حَيِّنْ وَمِنِينَ. Pure in your death, pure in your life, and pure in your death. He goes out, and he stands up, he tells Omar, be quiet. Omar is still, he sees Abu Bakr, the situation is unbelievable, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu gets up. At this point, this the massive courage in the man gets up and he tells the people, Ya ayyuha an-nas, man kana ya'budu Muhammadan fa Muhammadun qad mat. Those who are worshipping Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad is dead. وَمَنْ كَانَ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ اللَّهُ حَيٌّ لَا يَمُوتُ. And those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is living and He never dies. And then he read the ayah, the verse of the ayah of Qur'an, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ. Muhammad is only a messenger. قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ. Messengers have gone before him. أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ. If he dies or is killed, أَنْقَرَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ. Will you go back on your heel? Will you turn around? This ayah is so important at this point because it's important in its relevance to what's coming after the next few years of the Khilafah of Abu Bakr. He says, he tells them this ayah. And the one, وَمَنْ يَنْقَرِبْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا. The one that goes back on his heel, he won't harm Allah one iota. Umar radiallahu anhu, when he heard, وَسَيَزِّدِ اللَّهُ الشَّاكِرِينَ. Allah will reward those who show thanks of the ni'mah of Islam. How do you show thanks? By acting according to Islam. Umar radiallahu anhu, when he hears this ayah, he says, like he never heard that ayah before. Like he never heard that ayah before. Because that ayah had no application until that moment. To them, they didn't even think of that. That was the furthest thing from their mind. And everybody immediately comes to their senses. Abu Bakr brought that. Sa'd radiallahu anhu said, Wallahi, Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, Wallahi, لقد قمنا في موقف كدنا أن نهلك لولا أن من الله علينا بأبي بكر. We were in a situation, we would have been destroyed as the Ummah if Abu Bakr, if Allah had not blessed us with Abu Bakr. At this point now, the news is spreading. The Prophet at this time had appointed Usama, the army of Usama radiallahu anhu. Usama ibn Zayn, right? Who's ibn Haritha, who's the hizb of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's only 17 years old. He put him on this army to go and fight the Romans. This is a big ishara for us as Muslims. The last thing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is doing, despite the fact that there were false prophets now starting to rise up in the parameters, the Prophet is sending an army towards Rome. That's the last thing that he did. And then some tribes, the zakat collectors are coming in saying they don't want to pay zakat. They said, we pay zakat to the Prophet but not to Abu Bakr and not to anybody else. At this point, this is the day that the Prophet died, Allah alayhi wa sallam. The Ansar gather in the Saqifah, like a place of gathering for them. that is sa'idah. They want to make Sa'ad ibn Ubadah the Khalifa. They're going to take bay'ah with him. The news comes to Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr grabs Umar and Abu Ubaidah ibn Jarrah, and he takes them immediately. This is fitna. Fitna is happening because he doesn't want the Ansar and the Muhajireen to have fitna. They go immediately. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu stands and he says before them, he said, Wallahi, antum ya ma'ashar al-Ansar, idha dhakartum al-fadl, fa antum ahlul lahu. Any virtue, any blessing that you can mention, you people are ahlul lahu. The Muhajireen, the Ansar. He said, but Wallahi, you know as well as we that the Arabs will never accept a ruler over them unless he's Quraysh. This is the Quraysh, were the highest tribe in Arabia. And the Ansar recognize that. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu says, Wallahi, I don't see anybody other than either Umar ibn Al Khattab or Abu Ubaid, Amin Hadi Ummah. He's not going to choose himself. Why? Because he knows. One, he said, Wallahi ma harastu ala al-imara yawman aw layla wa ma taraktu Allah lil-imara sirran aw alaniya. I never saw this thing, this imara, this leadership in a night or a day, and I never asked Allah for it in secret or manifest. He doesn't want it because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Wallahi la nuwalli man talaba hadha al-amr aw man yahrisu alayhi. We will not give wilaya, we will not give a position of leadership to one who seeks it, that wipes out election. Right? Vote for me, nice to meet you. Kissing the babies and all these things. They'll do anything to get elected. They're seeking it and they're harisun al it. Once they get in it, they'll do anything to stay in it. Those two attributes negate a person that is worthy of leadership, according to Islam. So Abu Bakr doesn't want it. Umar, all of a sudden Umar said, he looked at Abu Bakr and he realized, Wallahi la ubayyu ahada wa Abu Bakr fina. I would never take bi'ah with anyone and Abu Bakr's with us. It became clear, cream rises to the top. That's the nature of milk. Cream rises to the top. They saw Abu Bakr. Umar puts his hand in there. Bay'atuka ala ta'atillah wa rasulih. I'm making bi'ah with you. That's bi'ah saqifah. The Ansar make the bay'ah. They all make bay'ah at this point, except Sa'ad ibn Sa'idah radiallahu anhu. Something in his heart at that point, he make bay'ah later. They go out, the people make bay'ah. Now at this point, unbelievable things are happening. They have Husaynah al-Kadhdhab has an army of 60,000. Sajjah, this woman from Bani Tamim, is claiming to be a prophetess, that she's got Bani Tamim following her. They've got the people of Oman, the people of Sana'a, of Yemen, are gone into rebellion because Aswad al-Anfi was there and he claimed to be a prophet and he was guiding people because they all saw the prophet, he's all of Arabia now is under him, so I'm going to claim I'm a prophet, maybe I'll get maybe a portion of it. This is what they're thinking. So they start making these claims. Now, what does Umar say, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu? We have to not send Usama's army out. We have to keep it here in Medina. People that wouldn't pay zakat are ready to attack Medina. They're actually talking about attacking Medina. Musaylimah is talking about it. Sajjah is talking about marching on Medina. The Persians are creating problems with the Arabs in the periphery of the peninsula. The Romans are there. So all of these problems, you can see at this point how fragile the Islam is. Because although many Muslims became Muslim, they did at a very late period in time. So the Iman had, the Prophet's core people who had been with him all these years were not that many. Massive people became Muslim at the end of this period. So there all these Muslims are, and they're falling apart. And so what does Abu Bakr do? He says, Usama's going. He's going to Sham. Umar said, you can't send him to Sham. Medina, who are you going to leave in Medina? Usama is already camped out, outside 3 miles. They're waiting to hear the news about the Prophet and then go, or come back. Abu Bakr said, he grabbed the beard of Umar, and he said, Wayhaka, ya Ibn al-Khattab, Ibn al-Khattab, you want me to stop an army that the Prophet ﷺ ordered to go. One of the last things the Prophet ﷺ said was that the army should go. He actually came out during his sickness, got up to the minbar, and he said, send the army of Usama. And you want me to go against his amr? The Quran, فَلْيَحْذَرَ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ. Let those beware who are disobedient about his command. أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةٌ أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Let them beware who are go against his command of the Messenger radiallahu anhu, that a fitna will afflict them or a great punishment. Umar said, wallahi, Abu Bakr said, wallahi, I won't do that. Then they say, they see he's resolute this, they say, don't put Usama at the head. The Prophet appointed Usama radiallahu anhu. Usama is 17 years old. There's people like Khalid ibn Walid. There's people, don't put Usama. Umar was in the army. And the Prophet ﷺ said, you want me to appoint somebody else after the Prophet appointed somebody? He wouldn't do it. So then he goes out, he walks with Usama. They say he walks some miles. And Usama wants to get down, let him ride. He said, ya Usama, let me just get my feet dusty, fi sabilillah, for some little time. Then he asks Usama, here's the Khalifa, the sama' and ta'ah is for him. And he asks Usama, Usama, will you allow me, a 17-year-old boy, this man is 61 years old. And he's asking a 17-year-old man, will you allow me to keep Umar here? I need him for counsel. And Usama radiallahu anhu says, take Umar. And so Umar goes back, and then the Bedouin, when they see the army, this is the beauty of the hikmah of following the Prophet. When the Bedouin see the army of Usama leaving Medina, they say, Medina is obviously not that weak if they're sending out this huge army. So now a lot of the Arabs are thinking, let's not attack it. Then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, another mawqif of shaja'a. Umar radiallahu anhu says to Abu Bakr, ya Abu Bakr, these people are new in Islam, let's just give them a spike about paying zakat. We don't have the strength now. We need to consolidate. We need to, right? This is what he's thinking. Abu Bakr says, wallahi, la ufarriqanna bayna salati wa zakat, wa la uqatilanna man yamna'uni iqala za'iran kan yu'tuna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wallahi, I don't separate between salat and zakat. Allah doesn't separate between it in Quran. And I won't separate it between salat and zakat. Even if they refuse to give me just the cobbling cord of a camel that they gave the Prophet, I'll fight them. And then the Prophet, Umar radiallahu anhu said, أَلَمْ يَقُوا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمُ that we can't fight anyone, أُمِرْتَ نُقَاتِلَ النَّاسِ حَتَّى يَقُولُ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. We can't fight them if they say it. And then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, didn't he say, أَلَمْ يَقُوا إِلَّا قَدْ عَصِمَ مِنِّي دِمَاءَهُ وَمَالَهُ إِلَّا بِحَقِّهَا. Right? Isn't zakat min al-haq? Isn't that from the right? And then Umar said, he realized, شَرَحَ اللَّهُ صَدْرَهُ لِرَأِي أَبِي بَكَرٍ رَضِي اللَّهُ عَنْهُ. This is tarbiyah of Umar, because he's being prepared to become the Khalifa. So in this position then again, Allah وَفَقَهُ. And then Fatima, بنت رسول الله, بضعة رسول الله. Fatima, there was a garden that the Prophet got from the faith, the Ghanima. He got a garden and he used to give Fatima from that garden, and he would give the fuqara from it. Fatima comes with her, with Abbas radiallahu anhu, and they ask Abu Bakr for the garden. Abu Bakr says, this is a woman who he knows the Prophet said, Fatima is a minni, بضعة minni. من أغضبها فقد أغضبني. The one that makes her angry has made me angry. She says, I want the garden. Abu Bakr says, ya Fatima, لقد سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول, إن معاشر الأنبياء لا نورث. We people of the Prophet do not inherit. Our wealth is not inherited. وإنما هو صدقة. It's صدقة. And she says, but he gave it to me. And he said, he gave you part of it, and I'll continue to give you from that. And she said, give it all to me and I'll give it to the Fuqara and the Masakeen, their haq. And he said, I'm the Amir al-Mu'mineen, I'm the Khalifa, and I'm ahaqqu li an aqsam. Ma'ala Rasulillah, ma'ala Allah. It's more rightful that I distribute the wealth of Allah. And so Fatima is really upset. But this is his, he's not doing it out of spite. I mean, some of the Shia Muslims, brothers and Shia said that he was trying to deprive Sayyidina Ali of the economic source. Yeah. These things, just dispel them from your mind. These people have the purest of intention. Abu Bakr had the purest of intention. And he's again showing us Deen is Qawaneen, is law. We follow them. No one is exempt from them. Not even the daughter of the Prophet is exempt from them. And then the last thing I'll finish, the next, the khutbah that he gave, radiallahu anhu. The khutbah that he gave, just a few minutes, inshallah, then adhan. The khutbah that he gave, the first khutbah, he comes up two steps and then stops and sits down. He won't go up to the third step. And he said, Ya ayyuha an-nas, laqad wulidtu 'alaykum wa lastu bikhayrikum. I have been put over you and I'm not the best of you. And what he's saying there, the Prophet said, Man tawadda'a lillah rafa'ahu Allah. The one that is humble before Allah, Allah raises him up. Ahmad Zarruq radiallahu anhu said that the qa'idah, a principle, if you claim some state or maqam or some station in Islam that isn't yours, then Allah will try you with imtihan and expose you before people. Somebody says, I'm a wali, then Allah will expose them before the people. If you claim a station that is yours, Allah will take it away from you. And if you claim a station lower than your station, Allah raises you up to a station higher than that station. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, وَلَسْتُ بِخَيْرِكُمْ I'm not the best of you. إِنْ أَطَعْتُ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَأَعِينُونِ If I am obedient to Allah and His Messenger, help me. وَإِنْ عَصَيْتُ فَقَوِّمُونِ And if I'm disobedient to Allah and His Messenger, rectify me, straighten me. He's giving the rules of Khilafah for everyone after him. لَا طَعَتَ لِمَخْلُوقٍ فِي مَعْصِيَةَ الْخَالَقِ That's qa'idah, that is the principle. No obedience to a created thing in the disobedience to the creator of things. So he said, if I do that, help me. If I'm obeying Allah, help me. If I'm not, then straighten me out. And then he said, الصدق أمانة Being truthful is أمانة The hakim, the ruler has to be truthful. He can't rule by propaganda. He can't rule by lies and deceit and exploitation and cheating like all of these rulers now. الصدق أمانة This thing is أمانة that I have. والكذب خيانة And lying is treachery. وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ الضَّعِيفَ فِيكُمْ قَوِيٌ عِنْدِي حَتَّى أَخُذَ حَقَّ No, the weak amongst you are strong as far as I'm concerned until I take what's due for them. Zakat. If you are oppressing the weak, as far as he's concerned, they're strong and he's going to look after them. وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ الْقَوِي فِيكُمْ ضَعِيفٌ عِنْدِي حَتَّى أَخُذَ مِنْهُ حَقَّ And know that the strong amongst you are weak as far as I'm concerned. In other words, authority is not going to frighten me. Power won't frighten me. These things won't frighten me. He's laying down the principle of leadership. And then he says, radiallahu anhu, وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ قَوْمًا مَا تَرَكَ الْجِهَادِ إِلَّا ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْقُرْمِ No people ever left jihad except Allah abased them and humiliated them. We know the truth of that statement. Wallahi, we know the truth of that statement. Ayn al-yaqeen, we can see it with the eye of certainty.